kidding, Elijah.
Good evening. Good to see everybody here tonight. If you're joining us online for the first time, I'm Pastor DJ. Thank you for being a part of our service. I'm going to ask you all to stand. We'll have a word of prayer and then remain standing, and we will sing a hymn to the Lord together. Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful for, God, your love for us. And as we gather tonight in your name, as your people, God, we pray that your Spirit is here among us, that he guides us, that he speaks to each of our hearts, and God, that he takes our praises and our prayers to you as well. And Father, we love and thank you. We pray that all that we do tonight brings glory to you and to your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's sing this welcome hymn together.
Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail him, Jesus the crucified. Sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, oh wonderful, deep and strong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song.
Find somebody you didn't see this morning. Welcome them to church tonight.
Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song.
One more verse.
Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals loud with hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song.
You may be seated. Dave?
Greetings this evening to all. Just one announcement from the first part of this morning's announcement. Anyone who's interested in going down to Baltimore to be involved in the Christmas shoeboxes, the processing of them down there, see Sonia. We're collecting winter items for the mission. Please bring in gently used coats, hats, gloves, scarves for men, women, and or children. And there will be a box across from the coat racks under the bulletin board. If you are interested in getting one of the new youth group t-shirts or sweatshirts, and you don't have to be a teen to get one, today is the last day to sign up. There are sign-up sheets on the bulletin board outside the church office with information on the colors and costs. Senior lunch is November 21st at noon. There are monthly calendars of our upcoming activities available in the foyer. They're updated every month. They left our various weekly Bible studies and other monthly or special activities. I looked over ours today, and there's a lot of stuff on there. If you look and pay attention, pretty much lays it out. And if there's any changes to that, Stacy will update them in time so that they'll be timely when you read them. Please make sure to take one of those to be updated as we're beginning to streamline our Sunday morning announcements, as you know. Also, Nate wanted to thank everyone, Nate and Albina, that brought food and helped them out during after she had the child. And I was going to think of his name, but I can't. Liam, yeah, that's somebody else's name in here, isn't it? There's another Liam in our church. And another one. he wanted to thank everybody. They wanted to thank everybody. And there's a lot of food containers back in the kitchen. They're not marked. So if you brought food to them and you want your container back, just go back in the kitchen and look through them and look for yours. Charlie Johnson's on a mission trip in Greece until the 14th, so please keep him and his team in prayer. Harper. And we have many who are sick and have lost loved ones, and we have special prayer for those and a lot of our loved ones and individuals that we're aware of on Wednesday night. So please avail yourself to that time together to just share these requests in a little bit more detail one with another and bring them to the Lord. We want to pray continuing against the abortion clinic in Rawlings, and for our nation, for the persecuted church, and for the peace of Israel. So let's take these to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the time we had in your house this morning, Father, for the excellent message we heard from your word. Father, we pray for anyone who heard that this morning and will hear your word tonight, if they've never made a decision for Christ to become a born-again child of God, that would take place even today. Lord, we thank you for everything that you're doing here in this church, and we pray a special blessing upon everyone who's come out tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, your words of wisdom for tonight. Somebody's already laughing. I didn't say anything. Thank you. When cleaning the vacuum cleaner, you become the vacuum cleaner. Amen. Let's worship the Lord tonight.
Father of creation, unfold your sovereign plan. Raise up a chosen generation that will march through the land. All of creation is lost.
How wide
One more time. Sing it out, church. With us if you're able. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. What an incredible God we serve. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will glory and praise.
How sweet the sound that sings across my head.
So good. Amen. As we were rehearsing this evening, I just kept looking at the words of that song, He Knows My Name. So as part of my prayer, I'm going to just speak these lyrics to you. I have a maker. He formed my heart. Before even time began, my life was in His hands. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls, and He hears me when I call. I have a Father, and He calls me His own. He'll never leave me. No matter where I go, He knows my name. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the God of all creation, When you walk outside tonight, look up at the stars. And you tell yourself, the one that made those knows my name. Don't believe the devil. Don't believe the lies. You matter. You're important. You are here for a reason and a purpose. From the very foundations of this earth, God knew you. And He knew where you were going to be in this very moment. Father God, who are we that you would be mindful of us? Let alone that we can be called sons and daughters of God. Joint heirs with Jesus. Lord, I am dumbfounded by the depths of your love. I don't understand it. I know who I am, and you love me in spite of it. You are so, so worthy of all the praise we could ever give. And I don't think eternity will be long enough for us to say thank you. Father, we love you from the bottom of our hearts. And we thank you for the wonderful opportunity you've given us to be here tonight. I pray your anointing on DJ as he brings forth your word, that you will till up the soil of our heart to receive the good seed that we are about to receive. Lord God, let it grow into something incredible. So in these last few moments and on earth, we can reach as many as possible. We can speak all we want, God, but only you can change a heart. So, God, we put it in your hands. Use us as you see fit. And again, thank you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Chuck and Amber. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians 5. We call them the three R's for some reason, because they don't all start with R. Reading, writing, and arithmetic. That's how we pronounce it. Must have been a Southerner who called them the three R's for the first time. Reading, writing, and arithmetic. It's how we begin to teach our kids. It's the foundation, or should be the foundation, of our children's schooling. But spiritually, the three R's, they don't start with the letter R either. The three R's we need to begin to teach our kids spiritually, and that we need to begin to teach ourselves, if we haven't already, are the three essentials of faith, hope, and love. 1 Corinthians 13:13, and now abideth faith, hope, and charity, or love. These three. But the greatest of these is charity. The greatest of these is love. Now, we have many times in this study gone over 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3, which connects these three essential virtues to the Christian life, and that's what this epistle is all about. In chapter 1 through chapter 2, Paul is giving his opening. He founds everything he teaches on the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus died for us, that he rose again, the perfect Son of God, became the perfect sinless sacrifice, shed his blood to pay for our sins, rose victorious from the dead. We serve a risen Savior today, and so we can be saved now, not by our works, but by God's grace, which we receive through faith. However, the moment that we receive saving faith, receive saving grace through faith, we need to exercise serving grace, and we do that the same way, by faith. The key verse again, chapter 1, verse 3, Paul commends the Thessalonians and commands us to be churches and Christians who are marked by our work of faith, labor of love, and patience of hope. And then in chapter 2 into chapter 3, Paul unpacks the believer's work of faith in chapter 3 through into chapter 4, the believer's labor of love. And then in chapter 4 into chapter 5, the believer's patience of hope. And then, as we saw last time we were together, in his closing comments in chapter 5, verses 12 through 28, he applies faith, love, and hope, because that's the order he unpacks them in Thessalonians. He unpacks those and applies those to the church. What should a church look like, or what will a church look like, if we as a church are practicing the work of faith, are laboring in our love for the Lord and for one another, and we are driven in all that we do by the hope that we have in Jesus Christ? Tonight, we're going to begin to look at what faith, love, and hope look like in my own life as an individual Christian, as an individual believer, if I am focused on God. Here is what faith, love, and hope look like when we are focused on God. Now, I want to remind you, as we did last time we were together, of what Paul says in chapter 5, verses 4 through 10. So let's review those verses together very quickly. Paul says, "But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that they should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night. They that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, whether we are dead in Christ and we're with the Lord in spirit, or whether we are alive here on earth in Christ, that we should live together with Him." And so, having then established our life in Christ, having called us to live out that faith, that hope, and that love we have in Christ in preparation for His any moment return. Remember chapter 4, the Lord Himself, at any moment, the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. The dead in Christ will rise first, and we who are alive and remain will be caught up together in clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. These three essential virtues applied first to us as a body, now to us as individual believers here in verses 16 through 22. We're going to look tonight at seven marks of a believer whose faith is focused on God, whose love is focused on God, and whose hope is focused, not in my circumstances, not in my emotions, not in my feel, not how I feel, but on who He is, focused on God. And the first mark is found in verse 16. Simply put, rejoice evermore. Rejoice evermore. Now, two words, but there is a tremendous amount in those words. The Greek word that is translated rejoice is kairo, which literally means, get this, glad for grace. You say, how can I rejoice when I'm suffering grief? How can I rejoice when I'm suffering in intense physical pain? How can I rejoice when there is great uncertainty in my marriage, or uncertainty in my kids' lives, or uncertainty at work, uncertainty in our country? How can I rejoice? How can I possibly rejoice? And the answer is, you, if you know Jesus Christ, can always be glad for His grace, for His amazing grace that saved a wretch like me. We can rejoice in grace. Now, remember, you cannot be saved without grace. For by grace are ye saved, through faith, that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. God's grace is a gift. The fact that we receive grace only through faith is a gift. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. So we have this tremendous gift of God's grace that was purchased with the shed blood of the sinless Savior Jesus Christ, secured in his resurrection. We can be glad for grace. But friend, let me remind you, you cannot serve faithfully without grace either. We have saving grace for salvation. We have serving grace for our service. And there are going to be many times when the circumstances of life as a Christian pile up on us and distract us from the Lord. And we have to remember that in all things, at all times, I can at least be glad for God's amazing and eternal grace. Listen to what Paul says in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. I'll pick it up in verse 4. But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God. In other words, Paul says, my boast is not that I'm an apostle, that I have this awesome title. My boast is that I get to be a servant of God, that we get to be servants of God. And being a servant of God does not mean you fly first class all the time, spiritually speaking. Now, if you can afford to fly first class or your job flies you first class, congratulations. That's awesome. Good for you. Good for you. But that's not the Christian experience here and now in this life. Because listen to how he describes it. In much patience, in afflictions, in necessities. In other words, in times when I'm like, I have a need, I don't see how it's going to be met. In distresses, in stripes. Those are the times that Paul was literally physically whipped. Because he was speaking the love of Christ, and the world, the Roman world, reacted with violence against him. In imprisonments, in tumults. We mentioned this morning a couple of the times that Paul got kicked out of the city. One of those times, Acts chapter 17, was in Thessalonica. Was in the city of Thessalonica. He got a mob was started, and he got kicked out of the city. In labors, in watchings, in fastings, in by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report. In other words, when somebody lies about you, when somebody says something about you that is not true, and then somebody else hears it, and they don't come to you and say, is that true what I heard? No, they just believe it for whatever reason, and people turn against you. People get angry at you. I mean, it starts in elementary school, right? This kid whispers to that kid, and oh, did you hear what so? And then we don't grow out of it for some reason. We don't grow out of it. We hear things and we believe them without verifying them many times. By evil report and good report. As deceivers, we're called deceivers, and yet we're true. As unknown, many people don't know who I am, Paul says, but God knows me. I'm known. As dying, because listen, we are all dying. All of us. My dad says it at funerals. I speak as a dying man to dying men and women. And I speak tonight as a dying man to dying men and women. But if you know Jesus Christ, you know the dying is temporary. This is the land of the dying. When we get out of here, we go to the land of the living, not vice versa. Behold, we live, Paul says. Even though our flesh is dying, we are alive spiritually. We have eternal life today. These things are written, John said, that you may know that you have eternal life. That you know that you have it today. I am immortal today, not in my body, but I don't want to keep this body the way it is now. I don't want to be balding forever in heaven. I don't want to have aches and pains forever. I don't want any glasses in heaven. But in heaven, we will have the eternal blessings of God as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful. Listen, you serve Christ or you don't serve Christ. Either way, you're going to still have sorrow. Life is full of sorrow. Life is full of sadness. Life is full of pain and disappointment because we live in a sin-cursed world. But if you are sorrowful and you know Christ, you can, Paul says here, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing and yet possessing all things. Now, there were times in Paul's life where he had a lot, and there were other times because of his calling, he sacrificed a lot and he had very little. Paul says in Philippians, I know what it's like to have and to have not. But here he says, listen, I'm in a season of where I don't have anything, but I have everything. I don't have everything on my plate today, but that's because it's being stored for me in heaven. And Jesus said, if you're going to store up treasures, don't be stupid. Don't store them up here on earth, because moth will get in and destroy, and thieves will break in and steal. It's going to break down. It's going to get outdated. Store up for yourself treasures in heaven. Let me keep it, Jesus said. Let me keep it for you. Let me improve it. Let me bless you with it forever. We can always rejoice. And if I am someone who is walking by faith in Jesus Christ, if I'm someone who my love is number one God, not Gigi, not Elijah, certainly not myself, but if my number one love is the Lord my God, and if I love him with all my heart and with all my soul and with all my mind, with all my strength, and if my hope is in him and not in my circumstances, then I can always be glad for his grace. I can rejoice evermore. And when I fail, which I do often, and when I'm in a time of need, whether it's because I failed or somebody else failed, or it's just because we live in a sin-cursed world, Hebrews says I can come boldly at any moment. I have instant access to the Creator of the universe. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. And I can come boldly to the throne of grace, and I will find mercy, and I will find grace in time of need. That is the reason I can be glad for grace, that I can rejoice evermore. Number two, verse 17. It's up here for us. Thank you, Linda. It's up here for us on the wall. Pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Pray without ceasing. Literally, the word, it's two. I'm not going to try to pronounce this Greek word, but it's, well, maybe I will. Let's see. Adialaipitose? Close enough, right? Close enough. Here's what it literally means. One word in Greek, translated three words in English. It literally means nothing left between. Nothing left between. Without any unnecessary interval or time gap. Help word studies. That does not mean that God expects you to walk around all day like you're some monk in a monastery and all you do is pray all day. Please don't do that while you're driving down the road. Okay, keep your eyes open. You can pray while you drive, but just do it while your eyes are open, okay? It doesn't mean that we pray every second of every day, but it means that in every moment where prayer is needed, we respond with prayer. That we leave no gaps open. That there is no time. That when I have a problem, I don't go to Gigi first, and I don't go to social media first and tell everybody how miserable I am and how terrible my life is because of what so-and-so did to me. The world doesn't need to know all that every day, okay? We don't need to know every single sordid detail of every relationship in your life. That's really not helpful. The first place you should go is in prayer, is to the Lord. And if you still, after you've already given to the Lord, if you need to talk to your spouse, if you need to talk to a dear friend, then absolutely, absolutely you do that. Guys, talk to your wives. Let them know what you're burdened with. Let them know what you're feeling. I'm just telling you, make sure you go to the Lord first. Because if I unload on Jesus, I'm going to probably, when I talk to my wife, I'm probably going to be a lot more discerning in how I say it. I'm probably going to be a lot less negative. I don't want to bring her down with something that I'm burdened with, right? So if I go to the Lord first, pray without ceasing. Don't leave any gaps. Don't leave gaps in the wall of your life. Fill them with prayer. Stand in the gap in prayer. Pray without ceasing. You know what Daniel did whenever the king was tricked into writing a decree? No one prays to anybody but me. What did Daniel do? He opened that. He didn't do it in secret. He opened the window just like he always did. And he prayed in view. Not because he was trying to get attention, but because that was his manner. That was what he did. That was how he looked towards Jerusalem and he prayed to the Lord. And even though it cost him a trip to the lion's den, he found out God will be with him in the lion's den too. Wasn't any surprise to him. He'd already been through a few things in his life for the Lord. But we pray without ceasing. Philippians chapter 4, Lord willing, at some point, I don't know if we'll get to it next year or not, but we are going to, Lord willing, if the Lord tarries, we're going to go through the book of Philippians together, a very, very powerful and encouraging book. But in Philippians chapter 4, be careful for nothing, be anxious for nothing, really, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, that's the rejoice evermore part, right? Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Some of you are like, I don't have any peace, I don't have any peace. And my question for you is, how much have you prayed about it? I don't mean how often have you prayed about it, in the sense that I pray about it every night. Well, yeah, maybe you mentioned it in your prayers every night, but how much time have you spent on your knees about that one thing? How have you fasted and prayed? Because when I set aside a 24-hour period and I say, I'm not going to eat, and when I would normally eat, I'm going to spend that time in prayer. When my body tells me I need to eat, I'm going to pray instead of eating. And I focus, and listen, I've seen spiritual breakthrough in my life through the discipline, the spiritual discipline that God has given in fasting. That's not just an Old Testament thing. Jesus didn't say, if you fast. Jesus said, when you fast. Now, I understand some of you, because of your medication or because of some other reason, maybe some health issue, you can't go even 24 hours without food. Maybe you could do a Daniel fast. Daniel just ate, basically, it wasn't just bread and water, but he didn't eat anything sweet. He didn't eat anything delicate. He didn't eat anything, you know, that tasted good, essentially, for a set period of time. And so maybe you could do that under a doctor's supervision. Maybe you could say, you know what, for this week or for these 2 weeks, I'm not going to eat desserts. I'm not going to eat the sweets. I'm not going to eat even anything that would necessarily be pleasurable. I'm just going to eat the bare necessities to function. And when I would normally eat those things, or when I crave those things, which, by the way, is anytime you drive down the road and you go past a Sheetz, or anytime you drive down the road, you go past an ice cream shop, or wherever your temptation is, then you say, I'm going to pray. Again, with your eyes open while you're driving, but you say, I'm going to pray, and we pray without ceasing. Number three, if I am focusing my faith on Jesus, my love on Jesus, my hope on Jesus, then I will in everything give thanks. And this is the application of rejoicing and the application of praying without ceasing, is that I am giving specific thanks for specific things at all times. Now, if you are struggling with finding God's will for your life, and I know this is a topic that we tend to think more is for high schoolers or college-age students, but I spoke with someone just this morning. I know God wants me to serve in this type of thing, but I'm just not exactly sure where specifically or how specifically can you pray for me. So even when we're parents, even when we're grandparents, if you're still breathing, hopefully you're trying to find God's will for your life in the specifics, if not in the general. Maybe you know you're in the job where you're supposed to be, or you know you're in the place you're supposed to be, but you need specific direction at times. We all do. If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally, but let him ask in faith, James says, not doubting, because if you doubt, number one, you're going to be unstable in everything you do. And number two, God's not going to give you the wisdom that you're asking for, because you're not really wanting his wisdom. You're just wanting him to rubber stamp what you want to do. And so we need to make sure that we're asking God for wisdom, asking God to lead us into his will. Well, here's where you start. There are only a couple times in the scripture where it's specific. Now, every command of God is God's will for your life. Don't misunderstand me. But there are only a couple times where God actually adds to the command and says, this is God's will for your life. So if you want to find God's will for your life and you're not sure where to start, start here. Give thanks. In everything, give thanks. Well, yeah, but again, my circumstances. Again, go back. Be glad for grace and give God thanks for it. Give God thanks for His creation. Give God thanks for the fact that you're still breathing and you're still able to correct some of the wrongs that we all have committed. That you're still able to earn back some of those rewards that you have lost because of unfaithfulness or because of doubt or because you were weary and well-doing and you lost the harvest when you were about to reap it. And Paul says in Galatians 6, you'll reap if you don't give up. You'll reap if you don't give up. Don't give up. Keep working. Keep striving. Be patient. And so we need to give thanks to remind ourselves. You claim a promise of God. You give thanks for it before you get it. Because it's guaranteed. If you will believe, if you'll claim it, I'm not talking name and claim it stuff here. I'm saying if God has made a specific promise and you can read it from the book and God has said, this is my promise. If you need wisdom, I'll give it to you. That's a promise. I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's a promise. If you ask anything, 1 John 5, if you ask anything according to His will, according to the Father's will, we know that He hears us and we know that we have the thing that we've asked for. That's a promise. You can take that to the bank. You can write the check out. God has already signed it. And you can take that to the bank. So we give thanks for the unanswered prayers before God answers them. We give thanks for everything. In everything, give thanks. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. This is God's will for your life. You say, yeah, but my circumstances. No, no, no. This is God's will for you. This is God's will for your life. Give thanks. You will find that when you give thanks, your perspective changes. If you're in my Sunday morning Bible study, by the way, if you don't have one, we invite you to ours. If you're a lady, Rhonda invites you to hers. Scott has a great class. Dave has a great class. We've got great Sunday morning Bible study classes, and it's a fantastic way to get to know other people, to share your prayer requests in a more intimate setting. I hope that if you're not involved in a Sunday morning Bible study, that you'll get involved. But in my Sunday morning Bible study class today, this is going to be repeat for some of you guys. But if you are forgetful like me, then we need reminders anyways, right? Proverbs says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat the fruit thereof. You're going to eat your words. So if you want a better meal, say better things. If you want a better meal, speak truth and speak it from a thankful heart. You rejoice evermore. You pray without ceasing. You give thanks and you will see your life change. The example I used this morning is music, how music can change our moods. We've all experienced it. Music can change our moods. You start listening to melancholy music, it will bring you down. You start listening to the blues, you're going to start feeling the blues. But if you will start listening, I've seen God do this in my life, times when I was struggling with depression or times when I was struggling with anxiety, and I'd start to listen to praise and worship. And obviously some of that is better than others, but you get some good, truthful, truth-filled, promise-filled praise and worship that isn't all about my feelings. It's all about His power and all about His gratefulness, His greatness. Let me get this spoken clearly. When we focus on His greatness, it will produce gratefulness. And when we speak it, we will begin to feel it. We need to claim it so that we can experience it in our lives. If you're struggling to find God's will, if you're struggling to find joy, if you're struggling with your circumstances, start with rejoicing. Pray all the way and in everything give thanks, because you are in Christ Jesus. If you're a child of God, you're in Christ Jesus. Your Lord and Savior is King of Kings. He's coming back for you. He's gone to prepare a place for you. The only reason he hasn't come back is because he's long-suffering, not willing that any should perish. The only reason he hasn't come back yet is because he loves people so much, he wants more people to get saved and to get out of here before his wrath is unleashed. And so we have many, many things to be thankful for. Number four, verse 19, quench not the Spirit. Quench not the Spirit. You know why sometimes we can't be glad for grace? You know, sometimes why we can't pray? You ever been in a situation you know you need to pray, you can't pray? You don't have the words. I've been there. I've shared my testimony with you before. I don't have time to unpack all of that again tonight. But time in my life when I was in a crisis situation and someone looked at me. I'm in a room full of students. So I got my pastor's son and the drummer of our praise team and a member of my youth group in the emergency room. We don't know if he's alive or dead. And Clark's mom's best friend, who was also a nurse, came out, said, "We don't know if he's alive or dead. The next 24 to 48 hours are going to determine whether he makes it, even if he is still alive, whether he stays alive. So we need to pray. We need to pray right now." And she looked at me, and I had nothing. I had no words. And I had to look at one of our deacons. I said, "Jack, you got to pray. I can't pray. You got to pray." You know why? Do you know why sometimes you cannot even think of the things to be thankful for? Because you're quenching the Spirit. Because there's something in your life that the Holy Spirit is prompting you to do, is leading you to do, and you don't want to do it, and you won't do it. And your arms are crossed, and you're being stubborn, and you're fighting Him, and you're bucking Him. Do you know that the Holy Spirit can be quenched by you? Now, He's not going to force you. He's not. The story of Jonah does not prove that the Holy Spirit will compel you to do whatever He wants you to do every time. Because there are plenty of other stories when people didn't do what God told them to do, what God wanted them to do. One of them is the story of Moses. It's been fresh in my mind because Elijah's been acting it out for the last week or two. Striking the rock. Elijah, please don't use that to hit the furniture. Please stop hitting the furniture with my flashlight because I don't want you to break my flashlight. Actually, it already doesn't work. That may be why, maybe because of it being used to strike the rock. God said, "Moses, strike the rock." And he did. Water came out, saved the people. Second time they came to the rock, "Moses, don't strike the rock. Speak to the rock." "I'm so mad, God. I'm going to go ahead and strike it anyways. You told me not to. I'm going to." "All right, Moses." Moses didn't know this at the time, but God was painting a picture of his son Jesus. The first time Jesus came, he was struck. The second time he comes, ain't nobody going to touch him. Now, we may touch him to hug him, right? But nobody's going to lay a finger on Jesus when he comes back in the second coming. The two-edged sword from his mouth is going to, anybody tries to aim any weapon at him, anybody that tries to take a swing at him, they're not even going to get close enough. Moses messed up the picture. He scribbled all over the picture that God was painting of his son coming twice. And so God says, "Moses, you don't get to come into the promised land just now. You're going to die. I'll let you look at it from a distance, but you're not going in because you messed up my picture." God didn't want him to mess up the picture, friends. God said to the nation of Israel, I can't remember off the top of my head if it's Ezekiel or Jeremiah, but there's a place where God said that you sacrificed your kids to the fire. And you did things that did not even enter my mind for you to do those things. Didn't mean that God didn't know they were going to do them. It means that God said, that wasn't what I wanted you to do. I wasn't tricking you and compelling you to do those things. You can't blame me for your wickedness. We can quench the Holy Spirit. God tells us not to. And so, I can depend on the Holy Spirit's strength. If you walk in the Spirit, Galatians 5:16, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. But if you are consuming, as Christians, we get caught up in bondage to sin. And if you are caught up in a bondage to sin as a believer, you are quenching the Spirit. And you got to deal with the sin so that you can begin to rejoice and pray and give thanks. Romans 8 says that if as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they're the sons of God. If the Holy Spirit's leading you to do something and you don't want to do it, you don't want to go there, you don't want to talk to that person, you don't want to do that thing, you're quenching the Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who gives us, 1 Corinthians 12, who gives us our spiritual gift and tells us by our spiritual gift where he wants us to plug into the body of Christ. And sometimes because Christians have been hurt, sometimes because Christians have served and they've gotten burned out, and the church will burn you out. It will. Somebody comes to me and says, I need a break. Take a break. That's fine. Take a break. Don't burn out. Don't burn out and fall out. Sometimes we need to step back from what we've been doing. Sometimes we need to recharge. Don't quench the Spirit, though, and refuse to serve. Well, I don't need to go to church to worship God. Well, you need to go to worship him correctly. Because that's what he said. That's where it's his family. Okay? Don't go sulking in your room. Right? I was that kid sometimes. Get mad, go to my room. Of course, being sent to your room when I was a kid, that wasn't such a bad thing because, you know, mom and dad didn't want to take all the stuff out of there that I wanted to spend time with anyways. Fine, just leave me alone for a while. Let me cool off. Don't do that as a Christian. Don't quench the Spirit. Use your gift. James chapter 4, the Spirit is jealous because we belong to him when we love the world. When we're friends with the world, we're provoking the Spirit to jealousy. We belong to him. But if we draw near to God, he'll draw near to us. And we have to cleanse our hands and purify our hearts. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks. Quench not the Spirit. And number 5, despise not prophesying. If I am focusing my faith on Jesus, if I love him and my hope is in him, then I will not despise prophesying. Now, need to stop for just a minute. Because this word for prophesying has two meanings in the scriptures. Sometimes it is used in the New Testament to apply to the written prophecies in this book. Old, new, the written prophecies in this book. Sometimes it's used to refer to the gift of prophecy, which is how Paul often uses it, speaking about the spiritual gift of prophecy, that God speaks to someone a message that he wants them to speak to somebody else. Now, I do not see any evidence of the office of prophet today. I know I have friends I dearly love. They'll send me videos of this prophet or that prophetess and what they've said. The reason I say I don't see any evidence of a biblical office of prophet anymore is because I haven't found anybody yet who is 100% right all the time. 100% right 100% of the time. That is the Bible standard. That is God's standard. In fact, in the Old Testament, God said, if you're 99% right, you are not my prophet. You don't get any free, you don't get any mulligans. You don't get any free passes. Because God said this, if you hear a prophet and he's only right 99% of the time, I mean, we think, man, that's almost batting 1,000, right? 99% of the time, he said, I'm just testing you to see whether you're really going to trust me or not. Okay? So is there still an office of prophet? No, I don't see any evidence of that. I have yet to find that perfect prophet. And perfect, I don't mean their life. I mean their prophesyings. But does God still speak to people? Does God still speak through people? I wouldn't be standing here if I didn't believe he did. I wouldn't be standing here if I didn't believe that he did. So we have to be discerning, and we have to, though, also be receptive. If the Holy Spirit is leading someone to speak a message, that we at least we don't despise it. So you say, well, what do? We do the next thing. Number 6, Paul gave us, and this is why we know Paul's not talking about the scriptures. Okay? He's talking about when God speaks to somebody, because he says, prove all things. Prove all things. And when you find the good, you hold on to it. Hold fast that which is good. So there are going to be times when somebody says something to you that really is from the Lord, that God has really laid it on their heart to tell you. And there are going to be other times when, can I say, the devil put it on their heart to tell you? It's not going to be from the Lord. You say, well, how do you know? You test the spirits. 1 John 4:1, test the spirits to see whether they be from God. So somebody gives you a word, somebody comes up to you and says, I feel like the Holy Spirit is telling me, or I just feel impressed, the Lord has just impressed my mind. Listen, again, if I didn't believe that God spoke that way, I would not have the courage to stand up here. I cannot, because I used to try to do this in my own strength. When I was a youth pastor, I used to think, what am I going to preach on this week? What am I going to teach the kids this week? Oh, I don't know what to do. What am I going to, I'd get so stressed. And sometimes I get to Friday and say, no, I'm going to change it. Sometimes I get till Saturday and I think, no, I'm going to change it again. Sometimes I'd be Saturday night going, I don't know what to do. It's so stressful. I changed the message 2-3 times. Sometimes I end up going back to the first thing. Sometimes I go back to the second thing. I can't live like that. And so I finally got to a point when I was fully surrendered to God, when I realized, okay, the Holy Spirit's going to lead me. I'm just going to put it in His hands. So when we finished up Revelation, I said, Lord, what do you want me to, we're almost into the holidays. I don't know that I really want to start a new long-term series. Where do you want me to go? And I just kept seeing Acts 17. I just felt like the Lord was impressing me. So that's where we were this morning. That's where, Lord willing, we'll be next week, because I felt like the Lord impressed that on my heart. And so again, sometimes God, I'm not going to stand up here and say God only speaks to me because I'm the preacher. So when we hear something that somebody feels is what God is sharing. Sometimes you're in a Bible study and sometimes somebody will share some real deep insight. But a lot of times it can be what Dr. Krokols shared, ignorance. So we have to be sensitive. I'm not telling you not to share in your Bible studies. We need to do that. We need to talk. We need to flesh it out. But we also need to be discerning Christians. And when we hear somebody share something, to say, Is that good? Is that something I can hold on to? Is that the Lord giving her insight or giving him insight into this particular passage of Scripture? Is this something that I can say, yeah, that is what this means. Yeah, that does how this how this applies to my life. If it is, hold on to it. Prove it, though. Don't do that until you've proven it. Don't do that until you've tested it. There have been things that I said that I thought were so clever and so wise and sounded so spiritual, and then later on the Holy Spirit impressed on my heart, that was you, DJ. That was you. That was not me. That was all you. And that might sound spiritual, but it is not biblical. And I've had to walk back on some things that I thought or that I said that are not biblical. So prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. The word prove here, dokumadzo, literally to approve by testing. And we hold on to the good. The good here is kalos. It means attractively good. Good that inspires. Good that motivates. Good that embraces what is lovely. It's kind of the New Testament equivalent of the Old Testament word tov, which is what God declared when he created light. And he saw that it was tov. When he created the firmament and he saw that it was tov, when he created Adam and Eve, and he said, very tov, very good. This is sort of the Greek equivalent of that, kalos. It is attractively good. It is intrinsically good. It is beautiful. It is motivational. And God will bring those words into your life. So prove them, and then when you get a word, you hold on to it. You hold on to it. You test to make sure that you're not just hearing something clever and something well-spoken and something that's delivered by a very charismatic speaker. And I don't mean that in the theological sense. I mean that in the personality sense. And we got caught up in people, in the cult of personality. And, oh, did you hear what so-and-so said? Did you see what so-and-so vlogged? And we reblog it. And I do that too. I'm not saying that we shouldn't do that, but I'm saying we got to prove things first. Because I see a lot of nonsense being posted. And sometimes I've been the one to post it, and I have to go back, why did I post that? Because I didn't take the time to prove it. I didn't test it. So test it, prove it, and then hold fast that which is good. And here's the last thing before we close. Verse 22. If my faith is in God, if my love is for God, if my hope is in God, then I will abstain from all appearance of evil. Now, abstain from the appearance does not mean don't do something if it looks sinful. That's the impression that I got when I was a kid. Well, if it looks sinful, don't do it. If somebody might think it's sinful, right? Don't walk into that movie theater because somebody might think that you're going to see the R-rated movie and not the G-rated movie, and so you've got to abstain from the... I heard that when I was a teenager. Abstain from the appearance of evil. Don't even go in that place. Don't go into that restaurant if they serve alcohol. Now, that may be your conviction, okay? That's between you and the Lord. But that's not what this verse is saying, okay? That's not what this verse is saying. The appearance of evil means the forms of evil. It means when you see it coming, you better run. It doesn't mean don't do it if somebody might think that it's bad. And by the way, the word evil here, poneros, it literally, in the Greek, the word that's translated as evil literally means pain-ridden. Pain-ridden. God tells you that evil is going to cause you pain. Why does God not want you to do it? Not because he's a killjoy. Not because he doesn't want you to have fun. Not because he doesn't want you to enjoy your weekend. Because it will cause you pain. Oh, it will be pleasurable for a season. It will give you intense pleasure maybe for a season. There's been times, man, all kinds of things can give us pleasure. Not just substances. Not just images. But emotions. Sometimes we do something and we feel like we got somebody, and oh, we feel so good because we got them. You know, like George Costanza. Oh, I got the perfect comeback. I'm going to nail him. I'm going to turn the car around and drive back and give him this insult and really get him. And it feels good. Anger can feel so good because it makes us feel powerful, but in reality, it's making us weaker, not stronger, because we're losing control of our own emotions. So we explode with anger. We think, oh, look how powerful I am. Look how scary I am. Yeah, congratulations. That little kid is scared of you now. Congratulations. You're so tough. You're so tough. That man is scared of you. Congratulations. You're so tough. It's weakness. It's the inability to control yourself. It will cause you pain. Agony is the inevitable outcome of all sin. And so to abstain means to separate from it. It literally means that you... I love this. Let me just give this to you. I know I'm giving you a lot of Greek tonight, but I think when we dig into the meaning of some of these words, it gives us real depth of insight into what God is saying to us. The word for abstain here, apeko, literally means to have... Listen to this. To have by separating from. It means you can have this... but only if you give this up. You can have this good thing, but only if you give this painful bad thing up. God says, I want you to have the best. I want you to separate from what will just destroy you so that you can have what will bless you. But you got to separate. You got to give it up. You got to abstain from it. You got to leave it behind. You got to cut it out. You have to flee from sexual immorality. You have to flee youthful lusts, which wage war against your very soul. God wants you to abstain from every sighting of pain. When we think of evil, when we think of sin, we got to stop thinking about the temporary pleasure, and we got to remind ourselves of the permanent pain that it can cause. The guilt, the shame, the destroyed relationships. We keep going back to that sin like a dog going back to the vomit. It's God's illustration. We keep going back to the vomit, and God wants us to remember how much pain it will cause. So where do I need to do some work tonight? Do I need to be more glad about the grace that God has given me? Do I need to spend more time faithfully in those necessary times of prayer? Do I need to start declaring thankfulness for the things that God has already given me and the things God has promised to give me, which are certain if I will believe? Do I need to deal with any ongoing sin in my life that is quenching the Holy Spirit? Do I need to stop despising the fact that God sometimes speaks to me through other people? But I need to test it. I need to prove it. But then I also need to hold fast to those things that are good. Do I need to start running from the appearance of pain inducing sin? If we will walk in faith, love, and hope, we will see these things more and more as evidence of that in our lives. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for these commands that are, God, at once both blessings and warnings, promises and warnings, that we will be blessed if we will do these simple but not easy things. And God, we avoid the pain that will come if we don't do these things. So God, help us to see where we need to do work. We all can improve in these areas. Help us to see where we need to do work. And God, we pray that we will experience that growth in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We're not going to sing an invitation tonight, but I just want to give you a few moments. Maybe you need to do some business with God. Maybe one or two or three of these things, the Holy Spirit really began to prod at your heart and say, hey, this is you. This is where you need to grow. This is where you need to work. If you need the altar, if you need to pray with someone, our deacons are here. I just want to give you a few minutes to respond to the Holy Spirit. Father, again, you are good all the time. You are faithful. You are merciful. You're all-powerful. You're all-knowing. We can trust you. You're in control of each of our lives, each circumstance. You're in control. You know what's going on, God. You see it. God, help us to trust you. Help us to declare your promises by faith. Help us to trust your Spirit instead of fighting him. And God, give us freedom from the things that are keeping us in bondage. We love you, God. We thank you for the victory that we have in Jesus and for the power of your Holy Spirit inside of each and every child of God. We love you, Father. Thank you. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, Lord willing. We'll see you on Wednesday night at 6:30. You are dismissed.